probably come here, well, I do come here more frequently than anywhere else other than our own church. So yes, a great blessing again. And quite a lot has happened, as Mike's already said, since the last time we were here with you. Not since the last time I was in Coventry, because I was at Canley 2 weeks ago. But yes, and it was very poignant singing How Sweet to Hold a Newborn Baby, having held the beautiful Theodore Lionel's hand, who is Laura and Tommy's newborn. And he's not very biased, of course, but he is absolutely gorgeous. But I don't think I've ever known, Lindsay, as I said, this as well, ever seen a newborn move as much as he has. You know, I think he'd be walking by next week in his face. That's probably takes after his dad. His dad used to play football 4 times a week, but I think Theodore's now had clipped his wings, so I think he's only going to be allowed out. Is it twice a week? Lorna's allowing him out now, I think, for football. Something like that. And of course, we've moved house. We do thank you so much for your prayers for these things. And as it's taken a year to get there, but we finally got there. Just feel so at home where we are. It's just lovely. And yeah, and spiritually as well, feel at home in the church. We also feel at home when we come here as well and spend time and have fellowship with you folks. I didn't sort out the title in mind, so I'm sort of hiding behind the lectern a bit today. But we got this subject, faith, this series, Faith Works. It does, if it's in the right object, that is the Lord Jesus. But our faith, of course, works out in our lives, if it's genuine faith. Because, as you saw in chapter 2, faith without works is dead. And so we're looking at this book of James. But this is our faith gauge to see where we are in terms of our faith. Are we at the mature end of the gauge, or are we at the immature end? And one of the tests, and the one we're going to look at this morning, is whether we're living in the light of eternity. That's a sign of spiritual maturity. Or whether we're living just for this world. And of course, heaven's going to happen after. It's sort of like a postscript, a sort of thing we just tack on at the end, but we occasionally remember that that's the case. And the strap line or subtitle, whatever it was that I was given, was this: live as if this is the last day of your life. So, what a difference that would make if you really grasp that, wouldn't it? So that's what we're looking at this morning. Yeah, of course, a challenge to us, it always is in James, but one thing that worries me about this church is that in your church, you've only got 4 chapters of James. Because apparently this is the last one, so you're not doing chapter 5. So you always got a good reason for that, but that's fine. So we're going to look at this passage, very short, James chapter 4, verses 13 through to 17, which I'll read now from the International Version. Now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow we'll go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business and make money. Why, you do not even know what will happen tomorrow. Where's your life? You're a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast and brag. All such boasting is evil. Anyone then who knows the good he ought to do and doesn't do it sins. So, yeah, pretty blunt, isn't it, as James is throughout his epistle, and very challenging. And if I pop this on a little bit under here, that'll be great. But a dry speaker this morning, and you probably tell my throat's a little bit croaky. I did a walk through the Old Testament church in Worcester yesterday. And I must have shouted at them more than I shouted at you when I came here, because it doesn't usually happen to me after a walk through. And it has on this occasion. So, it talks about making plans. These people who say, today or tomorrow we'll go into this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business, and make money. Now, it's not wrong to make plans. It's wise to make plans. For example, in Genesis, you have Joseph. He has just interpreted the dreams of the Pharaoh, And he said, look, these dreams mean Egypt will have 7 years of abundant harvests, followed by 7 years of disastrous harvests, and the potential for famine. But he said to Pharaoh, you need to choose a wise person who can oversee all this, so that in the 7 good years, they collect in the surplus grain that you don't need, and store it for the 7 bad years to see you through them. And Pharaoh says, brilliant idea, you're the man. And so he appoints him as this guy who's going to be in charge of this. But Joseph had that wisdom to say, I'm going to make plans. Based on that revelation of God, God hadn't sent to him in those dreams, through those dreams, or to Pharaoh, make plans, but that was the logical conclusion. But there's a caveat to that. In Proverbs chapter 16, verse 13, it says this. No, it doesn't say to Proverbs chapter 16, verse 30, it's Proverbs chapter 16, verse 3. It says, commit to the Lord whatever you do, and your plans will succeed. But that's the key, commit to the Lord. We bring them under his lordship. So, yes, we might make plans, but are they in tune with him? Are we ready for him to potentially redirect us? Because that's what we need to do if we submit to him as our Lord. And say, well, yeah, this is the plan. I think this is what you want me to do, Lord. But please, I'm ready to listen if you've got a different plan. And actually, we were doing that with the house when our first buyers fell through. It was like, okay, Lord, we thought this was the plan. And we don't sense you're saying anything different to us. But if you are, then please help us to be open to that so you can redirect us. So it's trying to hold those plans lightly in the light of what he might be trying to say. And to be willing to change. To be willing to think, maybe I've got it wrong. Well, maybe he's just been testing me. For example, you get this with the Apostle Paul of all people, don't you? Because in Acts, he's on his second missionary journey. And he has gone back through Galatia, which is a Roman region that we call Turkey now. And he decided he was going to go to southwest Turkey, the Roman province of Asia. But the Holy Spirit said no. Okay, you have to rethink then. So, okay, he went north to the province of Bithynia. And the Holy Spirit said no. So it's even the Apostle Paul, who was seeking to live such a godly life, thought he was doing the right thing. Yeah, God wants me to reach the lost. There's lost people down there in Asia. There's lost people up there in Bithynia. But no, God didn't want to reach them. Not at that point, anyway. He didn't take him to Asia Minor, as we would call it later, on his next missionary journey. He did pop in briefly at the end of his second missionary journey. But he redirects him, and then he gets this vision. That night, not the one night, from a man in Macedonia says, come into Macedonia and help us. And so then, yeah, right, we set sail, he said. And there they went to Macedonia, and the Lord used them greatly there to plant churches. So that was the key for Paul. He had these plans, it made sense, but he was ready and willing for the Lord to redirect him. And as we've often said, it's easier to. I said this last time, it's easier to move a sinking ship. No, it's easier to steer a moving ship, isn't it? That's it. It's easier to steer a moving ship. Let's get that right. So, yeah, we have to hold them with a degree of looseness there and to be sure that's what the Lord wants. And then also, we have to be prepared for the fact that the Lord might want someone else to do the thing we were planning to do. That's hard. That requires humility. And you get an example of that with David in the Old Testament. He thinks, tabernacle to worship God, that's good. Oh, but what about a magnificent temple? Oh, that would really be so fitting for the Lord. I'm going to build him a fantastic temple. That's surely what the Lord wants. After all, David was known as the sweet psalmist of Israel. He wrote all those worship songs, didn't he, called Psalms? Surely it's appropriate for him to build the temple. And then the prophet Nathan comes to him and says, sorry, mate. God says, no, you're not going to build it. You're a man of war, because he was a warrior king. And it's more fitting
that amount of peace built the temple. So your son Solomon would be the one to build it. Now David could have taken this crop. He could have said, well, I've written all those psalms of worship to him. I went out in faith and I killed Goliath in the name of the Lord. I've done all that stuff. He had it and I've messed up my faith. He hadn't confessed that. Well, why not me?
That's right, he doesn't.
It's okay. Right, I'm going to collect stuff, materials, to help Solomon so that he's already got a head start. So instead of getting taking the hump and getting jealous and bitter, he thinks, right, he's God's man for this job, I'm going to support him. And that's difficult when that happens, when we think, well, this is my ministry, this is my baby, this is what I feel called to do, this is what I'm really passionate about. And God says, actually, I want someone else to do it. Then do you actually say, okay, great, you know best. I'm going to support, I'm going to pray for them, I'm going to help them in whatever way you want me to. So again, we've got to be willing to hold things with that looseness that allows God to sort of just move things along in whatever direction he wants to. You've got these people here in Acts in James chapter 4 who have got these plans, but there's no sense that they've got that attitude. And their plans seem to be revolving around making money. Now, there's nothing wrong with making money. The Bible doesn't say it's wrong. It depends on whether money is our master or we are its master. Do we rule it or does it rule us? That's the key. And we get that spelled out for us really in 1 Timothy, where Paul says in chapter 6 that the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. It's often been misquoted by people. They tend to say, money is the root of all evil. It's not. Money is not the root of all evil. It's the love of money. That's the problem. It's the love of money. And you get a sense that those people who are saying today or tomorrow we'll go into this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business and make money, that's their motivation, making money. Maybe it's an end in itself. Maybe saying to you, look at me, aren't I rich? Maybe to have the most fantastic houses and as many servants as they could in those days. So that's what we've got to ask ourselves. If I'm making money, why? Is it so I can say, look at me, aren't I a success story? Look at me, look at my house, look at my car. Oh, do you want to look at the photos from the latest holiday I've been on to the moon or whatever it might be? So, that's the thing. What is our motivation? I may have told you before about my father-in-law and his dad. He told us the story probably a few times about some guy that he met, a Christian, who was wealthy. He just had the knack of making money. And he felt slightly embarrassed about it, actually. But he said, you know, David, my father-in-law was called David as well. He said, I believe the Lord's given me this knack, this ability to make money, so I can use it for him. That was his motivation. He was pleased to have the money to use for the Lord's work. So that's the thing. You know, do we spend our money on our house to say, look at this, or to use it for others, or our car, or whatever it might be? That's the challenge. That's the challenge for us, isn't it? But it's nothing about making money in itself. But these people seem to have that motivation. And this is where they're going wrong. You see, it's not they're just saying, oh, today or tomorrow I'm going to do this and this, we're all sorted, that's my plan. They think they don't just think they can control the next day or the day after. They think they can control what happens for a whole year. We will spend the year there, we'll carry on business and make money. The reality is they couldn't control 1 second of their lives. Our times are in his hands, not our own hands. And he says, look, you don't even know what will happen tomorrow. Oh, you might think you do, but you don't know for certain. We can make plans, but anything could happen to disrupt those plans. And so we have to bear this in mind, that our life is like a mist. You know, there's a mist you get in the morning, and the sun comes out and burns it away. It's gone. It's gone. It's just so temperate, some sorts of different images given in the Bible to emphasize our life is brief. We might think, yeah, I mean, there's the old saying, isn't it, based on the Bible, that the years are about 70 and 10, and in modern currency, that's 70 years. Some of us may live more than that, some of us have lived more than that. I won't point to those, I think, these two. But some of us sadly don't make it that far. But there's nothing compared to eternity. That is so brief. And can I say to you young people, the older you get, the faster life seems to go. I've got a theory there. You see, when you are 10, a year is 10% of your life. When you get to 50, a year is just 2% of your life. So a year seems so much shorter. And I just get that sense. And those of you who are a bit older than me or a bit younger than me are sort of, you know, the older ones among us. Is that how you feel as well? That just seems to go faster and faster and faster. And that's, you know, and of course you hear the folk who've retired say, oh, that's the competition. Well, actually, more hectic than ever. Sometimes, you know, they thought they were going to be having a nice, easy life, and it doesn't seem to be the case. But it just is so brief, our life. We might think it's when we compare it to eternity, which is forever and ever and ever, and it's nothing. It's nothing. And if we're just living for this 3 score years and 10, whatever God gives us, and not for eternity, that's so unwise. Surely we should be investing in what is going to dwarf our life so much. It's nothing real. It's nothing. Some of you will remember the old hymn, life at best is very brief, like the falling of a leaf, like the binding of a sheaf. I don't quite get that analogy, but never mind, never did. A be in time, fleeting days are telling fast, that the die will soon be cast. It's quite a challenging gospel hymn, actually. The fatal line will pass, be in time. And the point is, life is so brief. Life is so brief. There was a guy, Jesus, it's one of his parables, he told about this guy, this rich man. He had this fantastic harvest. He had, oh, right, really done brilliantly this year, fantastic harvest. Oh, what am I going to do? I know what I'll do. I'm going to pull down the barns I've got, I'm going to build bigger ones. And the story all there. And I'm going to say to myself, you've got so much laid up for many years. Take your ease. Eat, drink, and be merry. And God says to him, you fool. Tonight, your soul will be required of you. And who will those things be put to? So he's making his plans without reference to the Lord, not recognizing his life is a mist that is gone. And so, we have to remember it's so brief. So instead, verse 15 says, what should we do? We should say DV, which stands for Day of Lenten, which is Latin, which means if the Lord will. And I grew up in the Brethren, and it was very common, it was the usual practice, when the notices were read out, the person reading them out always finished by saying, and all these things will happen if the Lord will. And when you had different conferences, and you've got notices, conferences come round, nice little card, saying, you know, there'll be a conference, I don't know where, Church Street Gospel Hall on the 17th of September, and the speakers will be delivered. And it always put DV, or God willing, on the card. And it was a common practice. And I think that was good to remind us, yeah, actually, our time's in his hand. It's only if the Lord wills that these things will happen. Because you go over the top with it, you say, oh, well, this afternoon, I need to go to the shops. If the Lord will, I'm going to buy some cheese. If the Lord will, and so on. That must be ridiculous. And we can also use it as a superstitious thing. It's almost like we say, well, so long as I say if the Lord will, then nothing really bad's going to happen to me. And have that attitude. That's not the way to think of it. It's a bit like those people who, you know, oh, touch wood, cross my fingers, and all this sort of thing. Superstition. You don't want to make the Lord's will a superstition. This phrase, if the Lord will, a superstitious thing. You saw that the Israelites, they made the Ark of the Covenant a superstitious thing. And they their eyes were on the ark and not the God who it was to remind them of. So you get them going out to battle in the days of Eli the priest, when Samuel's he's there being able to have been trained up, and they take the ark out to battle thinking that's the answer, they're going to win the victory against the Philistines, and they lose because they were taking the ark but they weren't going with a real sense of depending on the Lord. And actually the ark was captured by the Philistines, and I saw that there's such a shocking thing to happen that when the old man Eli heard about it, he was sitting there fence, he fell off and broke his neck and died. So we don't want to go down that road, but we do need to have that attitude that I am submitting myself to God's will in everything I do, even if we don't say it with every sentence. But it's good to say it from time to time. It's good to remind ourselves, actually, this is God willing. I'm not sort of going to be so brash and bold and think I'm... You can always act like God by saying, oh, I'm doing this and that and the other, and never referencing God's will. But Paul often did that. You know, for example, in Acts chapter 18 and verse 31, on one of his missionary journeys, he says this, as he leaves Corinth, he says, I promise I will come back if it is God's will. And he used that phrase a few times. Excuse me. So, we have to keep that in mind. And he says to these people, as it is, you boast and brag. No, we're going to do this, we're going to do that, we're going to make money. All such boasting is evil. And in fact, if these people were Christians, they were going around saying that sort of thing. What they actually were doing was a practical atheism. Because when we got out of our plans, even if we're Christians, we're acting like atheists. They don't bother about God and what his will might be. So we need to make sure that we are practical Christians as well, that we're showing our faith with this attitude, if God wills. That's where we'll do things. But then, they're boasting. But then finally, verse 17, he says, anyone then who knows the good he ought to do and doesn't do it sins. And so we know that we ought to be doing things subject to God's will. But if we just ignore that and get blindly steaming on ahead, that's sin. But then also, in the context here, these people, they're going to make money. It's all about money, it seems. All about me. All about this wealth. But actually, are they so obsessed with that they're missing opportunities to bless other people? Because that's what they want to do. And there's a danger to say, oh, well, when I've made enough money, then I can give to the poor, then I can help people, I can do this or that. But God commends that poor widow who goes into the temple and she gives everything, just two tiny copper coins. And she gives everything. He commends her. She doesn't think, oh, I can't afford to give anything, I'm poor. No, she gives anyway. And so that's the attitude we should have. Give what we can as the Lord moves us. Don't wait until we're rich. Because for most of us, we'll be waiting a long time if it ever happens. So let's not do that. Let's bless people now. Think of the parable of the rich man Lazarus, where there's this rich man and he's just living lavishly, but at his gates there's this poor beggar called Lazarus. And this rich man, does he actually bother about Lazarus? No, he doesn't. He misses an opportunity to bless him. He's more interested in himself. And so there's that guy. Or you see the Good Samaritan. What happens? The Levite and the priest, they walk past the guy who's been beaten up and left for dead. And they miss an opportunity to bless him. They may be thinking, oh, well, I've got to get to the temple. I've got to do my service to God. Hang on, he's right in front of your eyes, on the floor there. Or he is right in front of your eyes. Do good to him. And then you get the parable of the sheep and the goats, don't you, that the Lord tells in Matthew 25, where he says to the ones on his left, as judgment, depart from me, you who are cursed. immersed into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes, and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison, and you did not look after me. And they will answer, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or needing clothes or sick or in prison and didn't help you? He'll reply, I tell you the truth, whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do for me. So let's not miss opportunities to bless others when we know we should do good in a situation and we don't do it. It's sin. So, really, we need to have that attitude from Proverbs 27, verse 1, which says, don't boast about tomorrow, because you don't know what a day may bring forth. Yes, make plans, but even if we don't say it every time, let's make sure our attitude of heart is, if the Lord will. Day over Lent, day thing, if the Lord will. The big thing today is to have a bucket list, isn't it? You've got your list of 10 or 20 or however many things that you're going to do before you die. If the Lord wills. Okay? So it's a bucket list with that caveat. So write on the bucket the letters T3 for you. Well, then you actually have a list of buckets, of course. And I'm reminded that I just want to finish on this, really. I can't remember who said it, but somebody said this. I think this should be our attitude. And it fits very much with this passage. Only one life. It will soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Because it keeps us in the right direction. Forgive us for all the times when we plough blindly on as if this life is all that there is. And in that sense, we're practical atheists sometimes. Help us to remember the bigger picture, that to be living for eternity, to be living for your glory, and to seek to use what we have to bless others and glorify you, instead of just seeing that as an end in itself. Help us to serve Christ. Thank you that His delight was always to do your will. But even said, my food is to do the will of the one who sent me. So help us to make that our food, our aim, our desire. That your name